Hello students. In this session, I'm going to discuss with you environment and ecology related all the questions that came in your prelims 2019 paper. Now, this was one section which was very tough. I'll be very blunt here, but it was the toughest section, I would say, in this year's paper. And if you look at the last 4 years of question papers, you'll see that increasingly the environment and ecology portion has started to become very difficult. And the main reason why it has become very difficult is that they have started to pick on something which is not visible. They have gone into the areas which are not normally read by the students. They have gone into the areas which are highly factual for someone to know. And they have gone into the areas, I would say, which is not prescribed as per the syllabus. And why I am saying this is, if you go back to the syllabus that has been prescribed for environment and ecology in your prelim syllabus, you'll see that there they have written that subject specialization is not required. But the way they have been asking questions last 2-3 years has been something which goes into a specialization of the subject. And we'll see the answers to these questions also, the questions that were asked this year. And we'll see, although some of them were very easy to solve, I would also say that there were a couple of questions which were impossible to solve or very difficult to solve. So let's begin and let's see each and every question. I'll tell you what was the difficulty level according to me for all these questions and what is the most suitable answer for all of these. Let's look at this question. In India, extended producer responsibility was introduced as an important feature in which of the following? Biomedical waste rules, recycled plastic rules, e-waste rules and food safety and standard regulations. So first of all, what is the meaning of extended producer responsibility? In very simple words, what it means is that the producer, which is producing anything which is not good for the environment, has to take the responsibility of disposal after the product has been used by the consumers. So this is what extended producer responsibility is. And once this is introduced, what the main idea behind introducing something like this is that the producers will take care of the fact that the waste is not generated at the source itself. So that's why this was introduced. Now, this was introduced as a very major feature in e-waste management and handling rules 2011. Apart from that, it was also mentioned in plastic waste management rules 2016, and this is the main reason why it was in use in last 2 years. So this word has been asked from here. So I would say that this was a medium to difficult level question. Next, consider the following statements. The Environment Protection Act 1986 empowers the Government of India to, statement one, state the requirement of public participation in the process of environmental protection and the procedure and manner in which it is sought. Let's hold on to this. Lay down the standards for emission or discharge of the environmental pollutants from various sources. This is perfectly correct. So you have either this or this. Now coming back to statement number one. Statement number one is basically about environmental impact assessment. And this was not a part of Environment Protection Act 1986. Although the discussions about Environment Protection Act and people's participation in the same has been discussed for a very long time. But it was not a part of 1986 law, that act that was made. And that's why statement one is wrong. You are left with only one statement, which is option two. So again, this is a question which is directly, which has been taken from this act. And see, all the acts, if you look at the previous papers also, you'll see that all these acts have been very, very important. And that's why the questions keep coming from them each and every year. So that's why this, again, I would say was a medium difficulty level question, because of the fact that this is something that is supposed to be known by everyone. Next question, if you see, as per Solid Waste Management Rules 2016, in India, which of the following statements is correct? Now, regarding solid waste, there was another question last year in 2018 also in the mains examination. This time they have asked in the prelims examination. So the first statement is waste generator has to segregate waste into 5 categories. Wrong. It is three categories. What are the three categories? Wet waste, dry waste, and hazardous waste. These are the three categories. So that's why this is wrong. The second option says, the rules are applicable to notified urban local bodies, notified towns, and all industrial townships only. Now look, what happens is most of the times when you have an extreme word means only, none, all. Whenever you have all these kind of words, understand that most of the times they will be wrong. And same is the case here also, because it's not only about all these things, but it is also extended to all the other areas as well. So that's why this is also wrong. Now, third is, the rules provide for exact and elaborate criteria for the identification of sites for landfills and waste processing facilities. Let's hold on to this. Fourth, it is mandatory on the part of waste generator that the waste generated in one district cannot be moved to another district. This is completely wrong. A junk statement basically. So the correct statement will be C. So this I would say was easy to medium level question. Next, consider the following statements. Agricultural soils release nitrogen oxides into the environment. True. So you are left with this and this. Cattle releases ammonia into environment. This is also correct. This comes from their feces. So 2 is correct. So actually we are left with only this option. So even if you don't know about the third option, you need not worry about it, because 1 and 2 only have solved the question. And this also has been something which keeps on being discussed again and again because of the amount of ammonia that is liberated into the atmosphere because of the cattle. But still, I would say that it was a medium to difficult level question. Next. In the context of proposals to the use of hydrogen enriched CNG as fuel for buses in public transport, consider the following statements. First statement, the main advantage of the use of HCNG is the elimination of carbon monoxide. No, not elimination, it is reduction. So that's why this is wrong. And this being wrong means this is gone and this is gone. Then you have HCNG as fuel reduces carbon dioxide and hydrocarbon emissions. Let's hold on to this. Hydrogen up to 1/5 by volume can be blended with CNG as fuel for buses. Let's hold on. HCNG makes the fuel less expensive than CNG. This is wrong. It actually very slightly, but it makes it more expensive. So that's why this is wrong. And this being wrong means this is also gone and you are left with only 2 and 3. And actually the price difference is not much. It's even going to be lesser than rupees 5 between CNG and HCNG. But still HCNG will be a little more expensive as compared to CNG. That's why statement number 4 is wrong. So again, this is, I would say, a medium to difficult level question. Mainly because this is not something that everybody would know. The fourth statement is very difficult to know. And here, one might get trapped in elimination. Because although there is reduction, but whenever we try to read something quickly, we tend to forget what exactly was written. So what happens is the reduction would happen by 70 to 75%. But we cannot say that it would be an elimination. So that's why B is the correct option. Next question. Recently, there was a growing awareness in our country about the importance of Himalayan nettle because it is found to be a sustainable source of anti-malarial drug, biodiesel, pulp for paper industry, textile fiber. The answer is textile fiber. It has been in news a little bit. You would have seen it in Down to Earth magazines if you read there, and a couple of mentions here and there have happened. And Himalayan nettle basically is found in Uttarakhand, in Himachal, and in Jammu and Kashmir in India. So in these areas, this is being produced and this is increasingly being used as a textile fiber to make suits, to make shawls, all these kind of things. Then next question, consider the following states, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Odisha. with reference to the states mentioned above in terms of percentage of forest cover to the total area of state, which of the following is the correct ascending order? Ascending order meaning increasing order. We have to start with the state which has the least forest cover and then move on to the state with most forest cover. Now, this question I would say is not difficult. Although you may not know the exact percentage of forest cover, etc., but still it becomes easy. Why? Because taking a guess here is easy. How? Because if you talk about which state should have the least forest cover in terms of its total area, it definitely is Maharashtra. And that's why ascending order should always start with 3. Then, after that, if you see, and after that, if we talk about which is the most, so obviously, Chhattisgarh will be the most. The reasoning behind it would be that these are areas which are still tribal areas, and tribal areas are protected areas. One of the reasons of them being protected is also that these are forested areas. So that's why Chhattisgarh should be the one which has the least forest cover, and actually the answer will be C itself. So that's why if you try to bring in logic here, which state should have the most forest cover and which state should have the least forest cover with respect to its area, then in that case you might be able to get to the answer. Because see, knowing the exact percentage of forest for each and every state is not possible for everyone. So that is one of the reasons why these kind of questions are being asked, because they don't just want you to remember the data, they also want you to logically think what should be the answer. And in that case, this is a prime example of such a question. Let's see the next question now. Which of the following statements are correct about the deposits of methane hydrate? Now, about methane hydrate, the first thing that has been given is global warming might trigger the release of methane gas from these deposits. Very correct, because many of these methane hydrates are covered in permafrost, that is in Antarctica, in Arctic ice, and with global warming, all this methane that has been trapped, this may start to come out. So that's why global warming can become a cause to trigger the release of methane gas from these deposits. Second, large deposits of methane hydrate are found in Arctic tundra and under seafloor, right? Apart from that, wetlands is also where it is found, and there are other regions where they can be found. So one is correct, two is correct. So I have this option and this option. Next, methane in atmosphere oxidizes to carbon dioxide after a decade or two. This is also correct, because normally it takes 9 to 10 years for the oxidation to start, and that's why in a decade or two it will completely convert into carbon dioxide. So that's why statement number 3 is also correct. So the correct option that we have here is D. So again, a question directly asked on methane hydrate, I would call it a medium to difficult level question. Next question, consider the following: carbon monoxide, methane, ozone, sulfur dioxide. Which of the above are released into the atmosphere due to the burning of crop or biomass residue? Now, you may remember the problem that we faced, especially in the northern part of India, regarding smog 2016 and 17. And one of the prime reasons that was given for that was the burning of crop or the biomass residue. Now, with burning of crop, carbon monoxide definitely comes out along with carbon dioxide. So one is going to be true. So this and this are correct for now. Methane. So since it is biomass, methane will be a big part of it. So that's why 2 is also correct. So 2 being correct meaning this is gone. You know, you're left with 1, 2, 3 and 4. Next is ozone. So ozone will not normally see a mention when it comes to burning of crop residue. So let us hold it for now. Then you have sulfur dioxide, which is definitely given out. So sulfur dioxide is also correct, meaning you are left with only D. A is also gone. So even if you don't know the exact answer to this question, you would still be able to mark it, because ozone, whether or not it's a part of the gases that are given out due to burning of crop, ozone is not making any difference in the statements that you have here. So that's why it's still an easy question to solve, I would say. If you have any problem with respect to sulfur dioxide, because methane, carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide will definitely be given out. Next question. In India, the use of carbofuran, methyl parathion, 4-8 and triazophos is viewed with apprehension. These chemicals are used as, these all are used as pesticides, and these have been in use mainly because they were either supposed to be banned or phased out or to be reviewed. So because of these reasons, all these pesticides that have been mentioned, they have been in use. So a question, if you have been paying attention to, this was there in the PIB also, and this was there in other newspapers as well. So that's why I would say that it was still a medium level question to answer if you had seen this, even if you have seen any one of it. For example, when it comes to, this was supposed to be banned. So that's why if you remember any one of the names also in the entire list, it would be an answer that you would be able to mark. Next, consider the following statements. Under Ramsar Convention, it is mandatory on the part of the government of India to protect and conserve all of the wetlands in the territory of India. This is the keyword, mandatory. It is not mandatory because it is not legally binding, just like the Paris Climate Summit. So that's why this becomes wrong. The Wetlands Rules 2010 were framed by the Government of India based on the recommendations of Ramsar Convention. True. Wetlands Rule 2010 also encompass the drainage area or the catchment regions of the wetland as determined by the authority. This is also true. So the correct statement will be B and C only. And this I would say is an easy to medium level question. Next question. Consider the following statements. Asiatic lion is naturally found in India only. Yes, it is found in the famous Gir forest in Gujarat. So this is correct, this is correct, this is correct for now. Double humped camel is naturally found in India only. This is wrong because it is found in China, in Afghanistan, in Mongolia, all these areas it is found in. So that's why this is wrong. So this goes away, this goes away. Then you have the third statement. One horned rhinoceros is naturally found in India only. This is also wrong because it is also found in Nepal. It is also found in Bhutan. So it is even found in Pakistan. So that's why this is also a wrong statement. So you are left with only one statement, which is one only. Next question. In the context of which of the following do some scientists suggest the use of cirrus cloud thinning and injection of sulfate aerosol to the stratosphere? Now, cirrus cloud thinning, what happens in this is that when you have this kind of cloud, this has an effect on the sun's rays, and it has an effect in a very similar manner as the greenhouse gases have, that it absorbs all the long wave radiations. And since it absorbs all the long wave radiations, it means that it will trap the heat inside the earth. So that's why by trying to decrease the size of these cirrus clouds, what we will be able to achieve is that more and more radiation from the earth would be able to go back and escape into the space and would be able to cool the earth. So this is something which exists as a concept. It's not that something is being done like that, but yes, it is something that has been suggested experimentally. So that's why this is with respect to reducing the global warming. Let's see the next question. In the context of which of the following are the terms pyrolysis and plasma gasification mentioned? Extraction of rare earth metals, extraction of rare earth elements, natural gas extraction technologies, hydrogen-based fuel automobiles, waste to energy technologies. The answer is D. And there was an extensive research that was done by Center for Science and Environment, and they had posted their result just 2 or 3 months back, where it was all given about how India is not doing well with respect to its waste to energy conversion. And this is where you will find the mention of all these kind of things, all these kind of methods there. Apart from that, in the Hindu also, a small analysis of the same report was also given. Even before that, in the newspapers last August, September also, if you go, you'll see the mention of all these kind of things. And that's why a question has been asked from here. So perfectly a current affairs question, just that they have gone into a little bit of detail. For example, everywhere the main mention was incineration-based waste-to-energy conversion that is being done by India and how India should move towards these kind of processes which are more efficient. So that's why this question has come, because of current affairs. Next, which of the following are in the Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve? Now, this I would say was the most difficult question that was asked here, because even if you look at all the answer options that have been given, it's almost impossible for you to be able to get to the final answer. The correct answer although will be A. Let's see the next question. Consider the following statements. Some species of turtles are herbivores. Yes, they are, especially the green sea turtles. Now also, there was one article in the Hindu where turtle recovery plan was talked about. And this is where actually it was mentioned about the food habits of all these herbivores or herbivorous turtles, and where all these species have been mentioned. So one is correct, meaning these two are correct. Some species of fish are herbivores. Now this you can take a guess. Even if you don't know the names of the fish which are herbivores, you know there are so many variants of fish. Now obviously not all the fish would be herbivores, not all the fish would be carnivores, not all the fish would be omnivores. So there would be some species that will be herbivorous, there would be some species that would be carnivorous, and that's why even if you don't know the names of any fish which are actually herbivorous, you can still take a guess and say that yes, this is a correct statement. So 1 and 2 are correct, meaning we are left actually with only D. Even if you see C, some species of marine mammals are herbivores. This is true, and this is true with a very famous species, which is dugong. Dugong is herbivorous. So that's why if you see, you have 3 here, here and here. Some species of snakes are viviparous. This is also true, but again, this was a very difficult statement for you to comprehend. So your answer actually should come from these two. If it does not come from these two, it's impossible for you to come to an answer finally. Because 3, although was an easier statement, I would say, but still a statement that is present in 3 of the options. So you cannot just eliminate after that. So that's why knowing about 1 and 2 are the most important for you. So the correct option will be option D. Let's see the next question. Consider the following pairs, wildlife and naturally found in. Now, this might become a difficult question, but if you know about this, that is Irrawaddy dolphin, you would be able to solve the question. Because this is a kind of dolphin which is an oceanic dolphin and can be found in estuaries, etc. So that's why it is found near the Bay of Bengal, Odisha especially. And with respect to Odisha only, a lot of times you will find that this Irrawaddy dolphin is being mentioned. So obviously it is not found in Chambal River, because it is an oceanic dolphin. It needs a condition like an estuary or an oceanic condition to be found in. So that's why 2 is definitely wrong. Now if you see, you have 2 here, you have 2 here, you have 2 here. You are left with only one option, which is option C. Next question. Why is there a great concern about the microbeads that are released into the environment? Now, microbeads have been mentioned in the newspapers, magazines, everywhere. Almost, I think, once a month in each and every newspaper and article, magazine, etc. And it is related to microplastics and related to plastic pollution in the oceans. For example, you might have heard about the Great Pacific Patch, which is just made of plastics and nothing else, which has been dumped into the oceans from all across the world. So if you look at the options, the very first option you have is they are considered harmful to marine ecosystem. Looks correct. They are considered to cause skin cancer in children. Not related. They are small enough to be absorbed by crop plants in the irrigated fields. Now, there is no mention of irrigation anywhere. I'm talking about oceans and seas, right? They are often found to be used as food adulterants. Completely unrelated. So that's why the correct option is A, and this is something which I would call as an easy question. So these were the questions that were asked from the environment and ecology point of view. Now, one very important thing that I want you to notice is that most of the questions that have come could have been answered by someone who is reading Down to Earth magazine or going through the Down to Earth website very regularly. Because each and every question that has come was somewhere actually mentioned in this particular website of Down to Earth or in the magazines that are released by Down to Earth. And this is a trend that I'm not just seeing this year. This is a trend that I had observed last year also, where we saw a lot of questions directly coming from this website and the magazine. Apart from obviously the ones which are purely static in nature, like the Wildlife Protection Act, like the Environment Protection Act 1986, etc. If you leave them out, all the other areas that have been asked in the examination were somewhere or the other mentioned on this particular website or the magazine. So I believe that in coming future, it is going to become more and more important, because obviously the coverage that Down to Earth has is tremendous when it comes to environment and environment related issues. And that I think is one of the main reasons why somebody who has done a good research on that website all year long would be able to solve most of the questions that have been asked here. So this is it from the point of view of environment and ecology. The question paper, as I said, was very tough. I mean, compared to most of the other areas that have been asked, this probably for me was the toughest part of this year's question paper. So this is it for this section. Thank you very much for listening to the lecture. Goodbye.